continuing on, we've got this program where we're asking for the shoe size. When they enter the shoe size, we've got that inside a try, so that when, if they enter bad data, and with users, we probably ought to say when they enter bad data, then it will jump down to the catch. And we're going to say, sorry, that's not a valid input. Please enter the shoe size using numbers. And then we flush the buffer to get the bad input out of the buffer. And then we're asking for the integer, the number again, right? And we talked about that if we entered this once, we get into that error handler, we get into the catch. But then if we ask them to enter data inside the catch, then the program dies again because it's not inside a try. So what we want to do is get them back up to where they are trying to enter the data. All right. So how do we do that? Well, first of all, do we know how many times the user is going to enter bad data? No, we don't. We want to do this again and again and again as long as the data is bad, but we don't know how many times, so that means we're going to use a loop. Do we want them to enter their shoe size at least once? Yes, we do. And so we know what we're looking for here is a do while loop. So we're going to do this stuff, this try and catch and the whole block there. We're going to do that while something. How's that for good teaching? We're going to do that while something. Okay? We don't want to read in the input. We want to send them back up to where they can enter the data inside the try. And again, why don't we just put another try catch below? Well, how many are we going to do? We don't know how many times the user is going to enter bad data, right? So the question is, what's the while? Well, could I say something like, if there wasn't an integer in there, what can we do? Now, there is actually a method called hasNextInt that'll go out and check to see whether there's an integer there. So we could say, while the in has next int, and then do a negative, and then don't flush the buffer there because we need the bad information in there to check. That's one way of doing it. I don't know why I'm telling you that. That was spur of the moment. But what we a lot of times we'll do is something like this. We'll say, okay, how do we tell if there's an error or not? Well, if we got into the catch, we know there was an error somewhere, right? So why don't we do this? Why don't we create a Boolean variable, call it error, and set it equal to false to begin with. Then, if I get into the catch, I know I have an error, so I can set the Boolean, the error variable that is a Boolean to true. And then, the while loop is very simple because I say as long as there's not an error, okay? And we could say, well, error is not equal to true, but that's the same thing as saying while not an error, and then it kind of reads like a little book, right? While there's not an error, then keep doing this, okay? And that works out well if we name our variables well like this. So now, if I say what's your shoe size and they say 10, it doesn't work. Let's see what's going on. I'm really out to prove to you this round, this series of videos, that I'm not perfect. I'm really doing my best. While there wasn't an error, so we're going to set error equal to true. If we get into that catch, and as long as there's not an error, we ought to loop. I'm not sure what's going on here, so let's trace through it. Okay, so I'll put a stop there. I'll run this in debug mode. Those of you who know what you're doing in Java are watching this going, he's an idiot. Actually, those of you who, anybody, regardless, that's one common bond about anybody who's watching these lectures is saying right now he's an idiot. So, okay, so we're going to step through this one at a time. So we get in and say, what's your shoe size? And I'll type in 10. So we get the error. We set that equal to true. Oh, I really am an idiot. We don't want to do this while there's not an error. We want to keep doing it while there is an error. The program was working perfectly. My brain is not. But if you knew how hot it was in my office right now, you would not blame me. It is unbelievably hot. I'm sweating like a maniac, and I'm sure you're really, really interested in knowing that. Okay, so if we run this now, let's try this. 10. Okay. Sorry, not a valid input. Please enter the shoe size using numbers. What is your shoe size? Okay. And then now if I enter 10 again, it's going to give me bad data. Now here's the tricky part. If I enter the number 10 now, it's still going to go back up and say, what's your shoe size? What's your shoe size? What's your shoe size? The problem is this. Once I get an error in, once that error Boolean variable is set to true, then there's nothing that's inside this loop that's going to change it back to false. It's just going to keep going. So even when I get good data, there's still a true in error because I haven't changed it. I set it equal to false to begin with, and here I set it equal to true, but there's nothing else to change it. So I need to reset that variable back to false every time I come into the loop. So up here I can say, when we come in, let's set error equal to false so that we've got, we're starting over. Okay, so I'll go ahead and compile and run this. What's your shoe size? I say 10, and it says, sorry, that was not valid input. Please enter the shoe size using numbers. What is your shoe size? And then when I enter a 10, then the program will continue on because I don't have any errors in that input. Okay? Now, what about if, I mean, if I just wanted to, like if I want to have a specific error that says, please re-enter the shoe size using numbers, the kind of annoying part here, I can say 10, and then if I say, and then it says, sorry, that was not valid input. Please re-enter the shoe size using numbers. Well, didn't I just tell them to re-enter the shoe size using numbers? What is your shoe size? I asked them again. Maybe I don't want to do that every time. Well, how do I take care of that? Well, if we don't want something done every time, let's take and move this line outside the do while loop. Okay, so we do it before. It's not likely we're going to get an error on a print statement. And so I'm not really too worried about that being inside a try-catch. Now, there's varying opinions of what goes inside a try-catch, what's appropriate and what's not. But personally, when I'm printing something like this, I'm not that worried about it. So I can move that outside the do loop. And then when I run this, it says, what is your shoe size? And then I say, the shoe size is 10. Sorry, that's not valid input. Please re-enter the shoe size using numbers. If I say 10 again, please re-enter the shoe size using numbers. And then when I enter the 10, then we exit the program. So we only ask this the first time. And if there's any error that occurs, I can print whatever message I want to. And then it's not going to go back up and say that exact same thing again. Just makes the code, or the, you know, when the user's using the program, it helps it work a little cleaner. All right. So that's error handling. That's exception handling. We get input that has the potential for getting an error, so we want to put it inside a try catch. The try acts like a net that's going to catch the data, and then when the error occurs, or when the error is thrown, is what we say, then it passes it down to the catch routine. And we can do whatever we want to there based on that input mismatch exception. Now, the only question is input mismatch exception the only exception that we care about? And the answer is no. There's tons of exceptions. So let's take a look in the next video at another exception and how we might continue to handle this. All right? Very good. Spencer dying of heat.